Well, the winter concerts at the Thomas Crane Public Library continue. This time, January 22nd, Robert Simonds will be performing from 3 to 4 p.m. And he joins us by Skype right now from Louisville, Kentucky, to give us a little information about himself, his background, and about the performance coming up at the Thomas Crane. So, Robert, thank you so much for spending some time with us. Really appreciate it.
It's my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Talk to us a little bit, if you can, about your background, your education, your musical influences, if you can.
Well, I grew up in Attleboro, Massachusetts, and I'm back as often as I can to the area to play. I make my living here in Louisville, Kentucky, in the Louisville Orchestra. But after leaving Massachusetts, I went off to University of Cincinnati, the Conservatory of Music there. And while I play full-time in the orchestra, I do a side project, which is these solo recitals. And I try and connect all the great traditions of string playing together, but primarily focusing on American music and American music by living composers. And then I try and draw a connection between the Baroque period, so like 17th century string playing, and all the advances that happened then. And then a little bit of hillbilly music. You know, the violin is never very far away from folk music of any country, any continent that has a violin, it's playing folk music, and American music is no different. So the concert kind of weaves together folk traditions, early classical music traditions, and music of today.
Now, was the violin always part of your repertoire? Was that something you were drawn to right away as a youngster and just stuck with it? Or how did that influence come about?
Well, maybe a little bit of column A, column B. My grandmother was a violinist, is a violinist, and she's from Holyoke, Massachusetts. And she now lives in South Carolina, where my folks are. But she got me started really early, and I stuck with it. And, you know, in my early teens, I decided this is what I wanted to do. And I studied with a wonderful teacher in Wakefield, Mass, in Lexington, Massachusetts. That got me into conservatory, and violin has been my livelihood since leaving college.
Your actual violin itself, the instrument itself, can you tell us a little bit about it? Is it something special? Is it unique?
Yeah, it is special. It comes from, it's an Italian violin made by a maker named Mario Badocchi. It was made in 1927 in Reggio Emilia, Italy. But I purchased it in, I think, 2003 from Rooning & Sons, the violin shop in Boston, when I was a member of the Richmond Symphony in Virginia. And it catapulted my career forward. It's a really amazing instrument, and I am very, very lucky to have it.
What is it that you'd like folks to take from your performances? You know, what kind of emotions are you trying to evoke as an artist?
That's a great question. People that are going to come out to hear a solo violin recital, maybe a little bit of a self-selecting group. What I hope and what I'm most proud of is when people come to me after the show, and they talk about the non-classical elements that stuck with them. You know, that a lot of folks do American music, American folk music, American vernacular music resonates with a lot of people. And so oftentimes people that might be most interested in hearing Bach and the other early big name classical composers that I play might not even be really aware that there are Americans writing music right now. And they also love to see the connections between, like the Bill Monroe music. I'm going to bring some music of Bill Monroe, some other contemporary folk music composers and writers, and I've adapted them for the violin, so you can see a big continuum of music making, in particular, like I said, American music.
Are all of the performances that you do solo performances? Do you ever collaborate with other musicians?
I do, but I found that, you know, like a lot of things in life, you like to have sort of contrary things in your life. So my day job is making music with 70, 80 people. And I won't say I'm told everything I'm supposed to do, but there's not a lot of autonomy in an orchestra job by the very nature of it being kind of a team sport. So the solo recital is a way for me to express a different part of my musical curiosity, which is to go up on stage for an hour by myself, play the exact music that I want to play, how I want to play it, when I want to play it, and so forth and so on. So I like to have those kind of polar opposites in my life.
Mm-hmm. At your performances, do you talk at all to the audience, you know, before or after the performances?
I do. I like to kind of thread, you know, a little bit of humor about, you know, the lives. You know, this isn't a very serious thing, you know. But I do like to draw the historical connections and the musical connections, and maybe even explain a little bit of the techniques of the violin playing and how, you know, a fiddle player from Western Virginia might have something in common with a 17th century violinist from Hamburg, Germany.
Okay, very interesting. Now, talk about the actual performance here at the Thomas Crane and what that will entail.
Well, it's mostly what I've described at this point. I'm going to begin with some music from the 1990s by an American composer, and then I'm going to jump around to some stuff from the 17th century, both German, Italian, and Austrian composers that really are the foundation, like the foundational text of how the modern violin is played. You know, the violin itself has evolved, like all other technology, has evolved over time, but it really had a leap forward, a massive leap forward around that time. And then I'm going to start threading in with the American composers who have drawn direct inspiration from the Baroque period. Those, you know, unaccompanied string pieces that were meant for a small room, a small wood resonant room, like we're going to be playing in at the library, and then kind of weave in through some American music and then American composers who have been influenced by the fiddle traditions, and end up again with some stuff that synthesizes all those things. So composers that are simultaneously influenced by the Baroque and American folk traditions.
Yeah, you'll be playing in the historic Richardson Room at the library, which is certainly a gorgeous, you know, wood paneled historic room.
I've heard amazing
things. I think you'll enjoy it very much. We're going to give folks a little preview right now, and can you tell us a little bit about this piece that we'll see next?
Oh, this is a piece by American fiddle player and composer Mark O'Connor, who, if you've basically heard any American music of the past 30 years with a violin on it, it's this guy. But he is a really distinguished composer in his own right, and arranger too. But he's written this piece that kind of combines elements of obviously American music, Appalachian Waltz, but also sort of Northern European folk traditions too. It's absolutely one of my favorite pieces to play.
Great. Well, we look forward to that next, and we look forward to your performance here at the library. Again, it is Sunday, January 22nd from 3 to 4 p.m. in the historic Richardson Room. Robert Simonds, as the winter concerts on the Crane continue. And Robert, thank you so much for joining us and giving us a little insight into your background, and we hope you have a great performance here in Quincy.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your interest.
You're very welcome. And if you'd like to get more information about this or any of the programs at the library, just go to their website, thomascranelibrary.org.